way cotton grows, you form the so-called primary walls first of the cotton cell. And the first thing that grows in a cotton fiber is the length, the fiber length. So the fiber grows in length first, okay? And the length has to be completed before the secondary wall start to form. And when the secondary wall start to form, the fiber start to thicken. So length grow first, and then fineness thickness or meat on the fibers grow after that. So that's the order of growth when it comes to a cotton fiber. And that's where maturity is very, very important, because it's that second stage of growth of the secondary wall, okay, that will determine whether the fiber will be mature or immature. And there are many conditions that affect maturity. Severe weathering conditions, okay, cold, rainy conditions, cotton disease, problem with the crops, sometimes premature harvesting. All of these are factors that affect cotton fiber maturity, and quite often we have to harvest the cotton prematurely because of expected chaos in the weathering conditions. So this is a key issue here. Fiber maturity is a result of a complex combination of so many factors. Okay? Not only that, fiber maturity is a very, very highly variable parameter. You will find different maturity levels within the field, within the same plant, within the same crop. I mean, fiber maturity is a very highly variable parameter. Keep that in mind. And that is why until we establish a very accurate method that is fast and reliable, it will be hard to expect the impact of immaturity sometimes in our process prior to processing the fibers. In general, maturity may be defined as the state of growth of fibers. That's a general definition. But in theory, and you need to understand the theory a little bit. I know I'm going to be talking about some mathematical aspects of fiber maturity here, but I think it's very important to understand that so you would know what do we mean by a maturity ratio today. And theoretically speaking, the fundamental definition of maturity that has been used is the degree of secondary wall development. Remember, we said primary wall developed first, and the length has to be completed, and then the secondary wall developed after that, where the fibers start to thicken. So the degree of that thickening is a measure of or an index of maturity. And the way we define that fundamentally is very simple. We use the circularity ratio or the degree of wall thickening, as I will define in a minute. What you see here in these pictures is fibers that exhibit different levels of maturity within the same sample. And some of the characteristics of the surface of the fibers is the convolutions that you see here, which is twist, really. I mean, you look at the single fiber, single cotton fiber, and you're going to see that fiber being convoluted, twisted. You wonder why human used twisting as a way to bind fibers in the yarn. You know, it's just a resemblance of how the fiber was made and how cotton fiber looked like. But typically speaking, an immature fiber will look collapsed and look very non-circular. Okay, and we'll show you some pictures of that later on. And a mature fiber will look more circular, more rounded. Okay, this is how we define the degree of cell wall thickening. Okay, it is simply defined by the ratio of the actual cross-section area of the fiber and another area. It's a circular area but has the same perimeter as the fiber we are measuring. So theta, or the degree of circularity of the fiber, which is an index of maturity, is defined by A divided by A0. And what you see here is a typical shape of fiber, of cotton fiber cross-section. We have the lumina here, or the center hole, and if you're talking about perfect maturity, then you may want to look at this circular cross-section shape here, where we have a very small diameter, it should be even smaller than that on the internal hole, and a large area of solid material. So that is the fundamental definition of maturity. Another definition is based on counting the number of mature and immature fibers and in between. This graph here showed you different rough sketches of how an immature fiber looks like and how a mature fiber looks like, and this is somewhere in between. And you can see that a thin immature fiber would have a very thin wall here, right? That means the whole fiber is nothing but a big hole. And the fiber, when it has that big hole in it, is not going to stay rounded like this graph shows. It will collapse. So really this side view here shows much better than this, okay, because it will collapse when it becomes very immature. While a very mature fiber will have a very thick wall, you can hardly see the hole in the center. You see that? And obviously it will be swollen, and you can see it on its rounded form. In practice, the way we measure that, or the way we look at that, we irrigate those fibers in caustic soda solution at about 18% concentration first. So the fibers will be treated by this caustic soda solution, and then we'll look at them under the microscope. And typically speaking, mature fibers will be distinguished by their visible convolutions that I mentioned early on, and will develop cell wall. It will look something like that, okay? That's upon irrigation in the caustic soda. Immature fibers, on the other hand, will look like a ribbon-like type, flat, collapsed, okay? And of course, a method like that would require some skills here to be able to distinguish between the thin wall and the immature and the mature fibers and the ones in between. But this method has been used. It is the reference method of measuring maturity. In many cases, it's the most accurate method, but it requires a great deal of experience and operator skills with how a mature or immature fiber will exactly look like. But when they use this method, they use the so-called maturity count, where what you have here is the difference between the normal fibers or the mature fibers and the dead fibers or the immature fibers. During that time, the ASTM established some values of a standard maturity count. What they did, they said, well, okay, if you a fiber that should be close to ideal maturity should have about 67% mature fibers and only 7% immature fibers. You still are left with a good percentage in between, right? Because 7 plus 67 is 74, and now we have about 26%, which represent fibers in between. But that was the standard maturity count at that time. But what that tells you here is if you test a sample under the microscope after irrigation of an 18% concentration caustic soda solution, and say you found that you have 64% mature fibers and 14% immature, 22% intermediate, then your maturity count would be 64 minus 14. That's really what that basically said. And they used to use this method in laboratory conditions. There is a relationship that was established by Pierce and Elord between the circularity or the degree of wall thickening and the maturity count. It's a very simple linear relationship. So if you can count the number of mature and immature, the normal and the dead, and they get a good maturity count, then you can estimate the degree of secondary wall thickening or the circularity of the fiber. But in practice, what we use is the so-called maturity ratio. That is the parameter that everybody is familiar with, maturity ratio. Everybody's talking about maturity ratio. So fundamentally speaking, what is maturity ratio? Well, maturity ratio is a ratio between the hair weight or the actual fiber weight per unit length divided by a standard weight per unit length. Again, this is the theoretical definition. And basically, that is what many people are using now in their maturity measures. It is the actual hair weight or the actual fiber weight per unit length divided by standard fiber weight per unit length. And what is a standard fiber weight? Very simple. This is the weight at the standard maturity count that I mentioned a minute ago, at the 67.7 mature-immature difference. Remember, that was the maturity count. So again, you still have to measure the maturity count through caustic soda irrigation and count the number of fibers, okay, and see the mature fibers and the immature fiber percent and get the difference. And then if you have a sample that follows the standard, that 67.7, then weigh that, and that will give you the HS or the standard hair weight. Use that with the actual hair weight of any sample, and that will give you the maturity ratio. Well, to make life a little bit simpler here, a maturity ratio will be defined by the ratio we just mentioned, or the ratio of circularity. And that's basically what the AFIS method used, is the degree of circularity, because the AFIS used an optical measure of the fiber. So how rounded the fiber is what the AFIS used for that. So what we are talking about here is a ratio of fiber per unit, mass per unit length ratio, or the ratio of the degree of circularity, or the degree of wall thickening. And again, this is the average circularity, and this is the standard circularity. And the standard circularity will be at a maturity count of a standard value, 67.7. And this simple equation here ties up all the parameters of maturity that we discussed. The maturity ratio, the ratio of hair weight, the ratio of circularity, and the maturity count. We ought to understand that because there are many methods of measuring maturity in the market today. We've did this chart before, and what it is, as I said, is a relationship between maturity ratio, fineness, micronair, and we have used this chart for the estimation or for the conversion of micronair to fineness. Okay, so as we develop better methods for measuring fiber maturity, these charts will be even more meaningful. Here are some values, typical values of maturity ratio and the corresponding criteria. Greater than 1 is considered to be very mature, and we now understand what maturity ratio means. And 0.8 to 1 is mature, 0.7 to 0.8 is immature, less than 0.7 is typically uncommon, unless there is a major problem in the crop that resulted in a very early harvesting of the cotton. And in this case, you don't want to buy the cotton anyway. If you look at the ASTM, they use the percentage. Above 85% will be very mature, 80 to 85 is mature, 75 to 80 is below average, 70 to 75 is immature, and less than 70 is very immature fiber. There are many methods, as I said early on, in the market today that one can use to measure fiber maturity. There is the Shirley FMT, that's fiber fineness maturity tester. There is the caustic air test, which is a very old test, but it's still used as a reference test. And there is the NIRA reflectance analysis, and there are commercial systems now, the analyzer 400, and there is the gold weight differential dyeing, which is an indirect method of fiber maturity. And there is also the AFIS. So we have in the market today many methods, and if that indicates anything, it indicates that we still do not have what I would call it a universal standard method of fiber maturity. That's why different efforts is being made and different directions is being taken. Okay? The Shirley Fineness and Maturity Tester, or the FMT, is basically a measure of the resistance to airflow. Okay, so it's very much like how we measure the microlayer. So it's an air permeability measure. However, the difference is it actually measures that at different air compressional levels, a high and low levels of air compression. That's exactly what the FMT does. If I remember correctly, a high of about 4 liter per minute airflow rate, and a low of about 1 liter per minute airflow rate. So now we subject the sample to high rate of airflow and the low rate of airflow, and the difference between the two is supposedly a function of the maturity of the sample. Okay, in fact, studies suggest that that difference of the air resistance of the fiber resistance to airflow at these two different compressional level is a function of the degree of wall thickening. Okay, so the resulting change in the resistance, as suggested by some studies, indirectly gives the surface area per unit volume, or it's a function of the average fiber parameter and the average fiber secondary wall, or the specific surface, as we mentioned earlier on. So the air resistance is used, and we can then use the, in fact, the FMT typically use the air resistance and convert it into an index of fineness. So at the very end, it will give you a millitex or some form of linear density, as well as a maturity ratio measure. The caustic air test is the test that I mentioned early. It's a cotton sample is measured for resistance to airflow. So again, it's very much like the FMT, but it's different than the FMT because we're talking about a constant pressure here, constant compression rate. So it's just like the microlayer. The only difference is you treat the fibers first chemically, using sodium hydroxide solution, and you test the fibers before treatment and after treatment with the sodium hydroxide solution. And of course, you know that what this solution will do, it will result in a swelling of the fibers, and then you measure the resistance to airflow in the swelling condition, the treated condition, and of course you measure it before you treat it, and the ratio between the two is claimed to be a good index of maturity ratio, and many people use that. So this is the ratio here, is the untreated airflow resistance or air permeability divided by the treated fiber air permeability, and that ratio is used as a maturity ratio index. Many methods that we have today use this method as a good reference, because a lot of research has been done using the caustic air test and the proof that it can be used as a second reference method in addition to the microscopical maturity count that we mentioned early. The NIRA method. This method uses, as I mentioned before, the so-called infra analyzer 400. It does calibrate against the caustic air method. So it uses the caustic air test that I mentioned a minute ago as the reference calibration method, okay? So in this case, a sample of cotton is placed in the chamber of the analyzer, and within 20 seconds after the door is closed on the sample, the maturity reading appears on the screen. So you can read the reading in 20 seconds. And that's what makes the NIRA method very interesting, because it is very fast and it's claimed to be accurate. Now, the NIRA maturity reading is the caustic air method reading. So it's once again, is the untreated divided by the treated times 100. Studies suggest that about averages, it's a faster method. It takes about 15 minutes to perform about 10 tests in the caustic air method, on the near infrared or the NIRA method, while it takes about 3 hours in the caustic air method to test 10 tests. The NIRA method also requires minimum operator skills, so it's not like the caustic air where special care has to be taken. There is another method, which is an interesting method. We've used it many times in our laboratory, the gold weight differential dyeing, where what you have, cotton is dyed in a bath containing a mixture of prescribed red and the green dyes. And the extent of absorption of these two colors determine the extent of maturity in the sample. So if you look at this here, we have a mature fiber will turn red, or it will absorb more of the dye, of the red dye, while an immature fibers will absorb much more of the green dye. This is a very subjective method, and you really cannot use it for absolute results here. What you can do with it is, if you have a sample in your lab that is well known by many other methods, that is fully mature, then you can use that as your reference. So you know now that how, if you dye it with that mixture of red and the green, how it's going to look like. Then you put another sample, the sample that you are interested in testing, and look at the differences in colors. And it involves some subjective evaluation. It's time consuming, but it does give a good idea about the extent of maturity. We like to use this when we suspect extreme immaturity in the fibers, the dye test. After all, if you think of any impact that the maturity or immaturity will have on down the chain of processing, it will have a great impact on the dye uptake of the fabric. Maturity problems, in addition to exist their existence in processing, and we mentioned the nips and all of that before, they also affect the dye uptake in the final product. The Advanced Fiber Information System, the AFIS. Well, the AFIS, as I mentioned before, provides an optical measure of the degree of circularity of the fibers. So it uses the theta parameter to give you the maturity ratio as well as the immature fiber content, okay, which is defined typically by a percentage of fibers with less than 0.25 circularity or theta value. How important is maturity? Very important. This relationship here shows you the correlation between different maturity measures. How the micronair is related to the AFIS maturity, for example, or the immature fiber content and the fineness and the nips. So you may want to look at this relationship. You will see here the K-S method, which is a method that I did not mention. It's really again, another dyeing method. It's like the gold weight. It is really the gold weight system, where the depth of dye penetration using the so-called Macbeth color eye is number one. Nips and seed coat nips. Most of the nips we have are result of immature fibers. And those immature fibers tend to entangle and form a ball of fibers. We call it a nip. Okay? So most nips, mechanical or biological, are a result of immaturity, in my opinion. When you have biological problem, immature fibers will tend to cluster together because they collapse, as I mentioned. So they tend to form the so-called white speck. Okay? Mechanically speaking, if you're dealing with immature fibers, the fibers will not be able to withstand the mechanical stresses by the machine, so they entangle together and form a nip. Immature fibers, long, very fine fibers, weak, very flexible fibers are potential causes of nips in the process, in the fabric. We need to understand another issue here, and that is, you know, immature fibers means low cellulose, period. That fiber that's collapsed, it doesn't have any meat in it, so you don't have much cellulose. Now, if you recall, we talked about the cellulosic polymer early on in the previous session, and we said that the cellulosic polymer has the active hydroxyl group and all of that, which attract water and attract dye. So if you have an immature fiber, that immature fiber does not have enough cellulosic polymer, doesn't have beef in it. So as a result of that, it does not absorb dye. And you can easily see that in the fabric. You know, when you see a white speck in the fabric, or you see spots in the fabric that did not dye well, this is a cluster of immature fibers. Not enough cellulose, not enough absorption of dye. Leads us to another problem, fabric barre. You know, these are defects characterized by textural bands of or color bands in the course of a knit fabric or in the filling direction in the weaving and the woven fabric. Fabric barre is a major issue. There are many factors that can contribute to barre, including variation in the mix, in the fineness, on the micronair, on the color. You want to watch out for the consistency in the micronair, and more importantly, in some cases, the consistency in the color. If you will allow, for example, the yellowness of the fiber, the plus P, to swing high and low, then you more than likely getting yourself into major barre problem. Quite often we see the effect of plus B on woven gray fabric before dyeing. And you can see the stripes, you can see the textural bands in the woven fabric before dyeing even. So be careful, it's color and the fineness. Most mills use, before I go to that, maturity as well is an issue. Because as I just mentioned, maturity means color dye uptake. And if you have one mature mix, one immature mix, then you know what you're running yourself into. A 0.5%, 1% difference in the level of maturity from one mix to another could mean a major fabric barre. And that's why we are in a bad need to measure fiber maturity accurately and rapidly. Variation in mix, variation in fineness would lead to variation in yarn quality, in hairiness, in twist, in variation in yarn count, and all of that would lead to fabric barre. Okay, so you need to make sure that you understand these aspects in relation to fabric barre. They are major contributing reasons. This is even more obvious when a mill is using different varieties, or there is a switch in the crop, there is a change from one crop to another, with different type of cotton and different levels of maturity and so on. That's when we experience major barre.